I'm ready. Okay. Well, leave it there. We're good. Okay. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. If you'd go ahead and start coming in, we have seats down front. If we need to find some more, we will do that. Please come in and have a seat. While folks are making their way in, I'll go ahead and ask a couple of favors. And the first one is this thing, right? So everybody's got one in their pocket, I'm certain. And if you wouldn't mind, let's pull it out and let's put it either on off or vibrate or something so that it doesn't go off in between. There used to be an old joke that if one of these went off in the middle of one of the programs put on by our association, we would be sending a director or someone from the staff to collect $20 for the scholarship fund. Now, we'll put that one on hold for today, but I know you appreciate that we want to try to keep it quiet so everybody can hear the program today. So please go ahead and come on in. And while you're making your way in, I'm going to go ahead and start in the interest of keeping the program on time. Again, good afternoon. My name is Sherry Baer. I am Director of Development for the American Jersey Cattle Association. We're based out of Reynoldsburg, Ohio, which is a suburb of Columbus. And it is a pleasure to present our sponsored program of the virtual farm tour of Lyon Jerseys, LLC, from Toledo, Iowa. Now, I want to say something here before we get started. The idea of the virtual farm tour always is that a program would be put together, and then the producer or producer's families, you know, you could get several people engaged in this program, would be here to stand right here where I am and narrate the program for you. For the first time in the history of the virtual farm tours at World Dairy Expo, unfortunately, because of illness, our narrator will not be here today. So you get me instead. And I will say this. You're going to get the report from me, but you're not going to get the voice of Eric Lyon. And I do apologize for that, but hopefully we will have a good program here this morning. There's still some seats down towards the front here. We'll fill in as we go along. Okay. However, we do have a couple of members of the Lyon family here today that I would like to recognize. Right up here in front of me, Kurt Lyon, if you'd stand, Kurt, and turn around, who is Eric's younger brother, is here. And then Tom Lyon is back there, and that is Joe's brother, if I've got this all correct, right? And I think we've got a few other folks that will get introduced along the way. Lyon Jerseys was selected for this program this year because it is one of our legacy herds. This herd has been in business, or soon will be in business, for 90 years with registered jerseys. And our program today is about getting the most out of a herd that is not going to expand. So as we visit, let me make an introduction of the partners here. In the center is Joe Lyon, who with his brother Howard started the original partnership here at Lyon Jerseys. Then on the left, well, now he's moved on me. All right, I apologize. This is not starting out well already, is it? All right, we'll get on track here. Okay, so Joe Lyon here, then his son, Eric, who would have been here making the presentation today, and then Howard's son and their nephew, or Joe's nephew, Stuart. So this operation has been in, this partnership has been in business since about 1980. Howard passed away in 1989, and that gives you a sense of who the partners are in the operation of Lyon Jerseys today. One of the things that we want to talk about here is this operation has been known for breeding registered Jersey cattle of extraordinary quality for decades. They have been pioneers in soil and water conservation in Tama County and in Iowa. We'll talk a little bit about Joe's role in establishing multiple component pricing that has affected the profitability of dairy producers and milk marketing cooperatives all across the United States, not just in the upper Midwest. And then, of course, this family has been leaders for decades in breed association activities, in dairy promotion, and in product marketing from all angles, and especially to the consumers. So as I said before, 90 years with registered jerseys. This picture shows four of the sons back in the old days hand milking. It's a picture that you'll actually see in the milk barn if you go to the dairy. And the quote here is taken from the ad that was published in Jersey Journal on the 50th anniversary. And I think it summarizes or just succinctly states what the story is at Lyon Jerseys. The emphasis has always been on an efficient Jersey cow that produces profitably. This condition has been met with our Jerseys doing their job in feeding and educating the Lyon clan and adding land to the dairy development or to the dairy enterprise. So in 1958, which is I'm going to use as my benchmark here today, they were milking 44 cows and they were farming 320 acres. And I want to give you a little grand tour of the farm such as it is today. This is the main dairy operation. The address is K Avenue, which is the road running right through the middle of it. The main dairy complex is here. We'll get on a ground level tour of it here shortly, but the milk barn, the parlor, the holding pens, all the way out to the barns, which have been expanded basically to the east over the years, commodity shed, storage area, heifer, young calf heifer raising area. Eric's home is over here, and then there's a transition, a young stock operation for the heifers as they move out of the weaning area. About a mile to the north, there's a second set of facilities here that handle the bulls, and we'll talk about bulls, Jersey bulls, here today, and then replacement heifers, and what this particular picture is missing is yet another hoop barn right here to handle the replacement heifers and the ones getting ready to freshen. And then a third facility quite a ways away that houses the older bulls, the dry cows, and this operation uses a lot of pasture, about 300 acres in bluegrass, if I remember correctly, as far as that's concerned. But let's get the bigger picture here, all right? I'm pulling way back on the basic, the center of the dairy. And Earl Lyon, who was Joe's father, was a pioneer in soil conservation practices in Tama County, Iowa. They were the first to lay out contour strips, and they did strip cropping, minimum tillage, runoff management, put in winter cover crops, and you kind of get a sense of the layout here as you look at this aerial view. So let's take a little closer look at the dairy as though you were walking around it, okay? So this is if you were at Eric's farm and you were looking down to the south and west. Now we're coming in the main driveway here and just happened to be there that day when the milk truck driver was coming in. You come off of the holding or the parlor coming back through here. This is a double 12 parlor that has throughput the highest throughput is 100 cows an hour that they can put through there. Little bit of the things that they do to manage and communicate with their employees on a daily basis. Now we're looking up here in different, I did it again, I apologize. Let me see if I can advance it. There we go. So getting up here, so the various freestall barns, this newest barn back here is about 10 years old, bedded with sand as they all are. Then a lot of headlocks on the newer facilities, the rail on the outside, and they drive up feeding on this side. So you see here, the barns are scraped down twice a day. During the summer in particular, it's moved to this liquid storage area spread on the fields. Joe and Eric and Stuart were particularly thrilled by the condition of the corn crop when we did this video at the end of August. Talked to him, and it's just been a bumper crop all the way through this year. They're very, very pleased with their yields. And then the commodity shed here that you see, they've been feeding a TMR for many, many years, very successfully, as we will see in their production statistics. And just thought we might take a quick run down here and walk past the different bays in the barn. So Lyon Jerseys has been on AJCA production and breed improvement programs forever, quite frankly. As best as we can trace it back, 1961 with the basic DHIR program. So they have had continuous records and type evaluation for all of these years. They were among the first herds to go on the AJCA REAP program when it was brought into being in 1995 and have been on it continuously ever since. And I want to talk just a smidgen about what REAP is, because those three letters have particular meaning. This is a package of the core services for the American Jersey Cattle Association. REAP being the registration or your animal ID, permanent database, and pedigree building. P for the production testing and building your pedigrees and putting that information out into your evaluations. A for appraisal or type evaluation. And E, the one that is perhaps the most important when it comes to talking about Lyon Jerseys, the equity program. Equity in milk pricing, multiple component pricing, dairy farmers receiving the value of their milk as it is in consumer products, the fat, the protein, other solids. In other words, it's not volume, it's what that means to consumer products. And those are all in this particular program. So you see here the lactation average. This is a 305-day ME basis up here on 331 lactations completed last year. On an actual basis, those cows averaged a little over 18,000 of milk at 5.2 fat and 3.6% protein. We'll have a little bit of discussion about that too as we go down the road. The type evaluation about 3 weeks ago, the appraiser was through the dairy. 382 cows in the herd today are scored, averaging 84 points. AJCA is on a 10-point scale, so your excellence are 90, your very goods are in the 80s, your desirables in the 70s. Okay, so you get a sense, and 84% on the entire herd. 59 excellent, of which 10 of those are 92-point cows. 16 at 91 and 33 at 90%, 274 very good, and nothing is under desirable in that herd today. So I want to talk a little bit, and this is really where we're going to miss having Eric, because the breeding philosophy is something that is near and dear to his heart. When he came back, when he graduated from Iowa State, he went to work for Curtis Breeding Service. And he worked with some of the great dairy sire analysts of that era, and then had an opportunity to come back to the dairy farm in 1980. And so what did he bring back with him and bring into the operation? Well, the first thing of it is Joe Lyon was actually president of the American Jersey Cattle Club just after the adoption of the USDA predicted difference sire valuations being the official way to rank bulls for our association, okay? And he was a tremendous advocate for using the scientific basis in breeding selection. So they believe in the scientific evaluations, and they have used those consistently for all of these years. And you'll see the effects of that in the pictures of these cows, because generations after generations of high genetic merit bulls have paid off for them. So their objectives have basically been always a balance of type, longevity, and production. They breed for butterfat and protein pounds. And I'll have another slide here that'll show you why that matters to them. And then udder traits are tremendously high on their list of what they're selecting for. They have also been huge proponents of young sire sampling over the years. They were members of Dairyland Jersey Sires, which is a regional young sire sampling group. They have used young sires from all of the AI organizations that they purchased semen from over the years. And again, they have been at the leading edge in helping advance breed improvement in young sire sampling. Now, one of the things here, there was an ad in the magazine probably 10 years ago now, where Eric cited a statement by Jeremiah Spurflaga, who was their nutritionist, and a young man who works for Nelson Dairy Consultants. And he was speaking at a conference, and he said, you know, there's a practical limit, we think, in feeding cows. But what you can do is you're miles away from the maximum amount of fat and protein that you can put into that milk. And that's where they're selecting for high component sires. In other words, they need to be plus, at least break even, if not plus, for percent fat and percent protein when they're using bulls and selecting them for the herd. So that gives you some sense of where they're coming from, okay? So where are they today? DHI herd average is rolling right now at 17,005 at 5'2", 917 pounds of fat, 3'7", 647 of protein. The tank average last test was 60 pounds. Across the course of the year, basically the SCC is about 200,000. They have, for 28 consecutive years, received the Blue Ribbon Milk Quality Award from Swiss Valley. Last year, that herd average, as impressive as it was a tough year for weather, and it was a tough year for their feed. This year, over 80 cows have finished records to date of 1,000 pounds of fat, and we've still got 3 months to go. The herd average age is 51 months. The involuntary culling rate is 14%. So given Jersey's ability to reproduce your internal herd growth potential, this gives them a tremendous set of cattle that they can then sell out as excess replacement stock. It's another revenue stream. And it goes to that thing of how you take a herd that's going to be basically this size and maximize your revenue from it. Calving interval at 13.1, and your pregnancy rate at 27%. So a very, very well-managed operation. 12 full-time employees for the entire operation, 400 milking cows, essentially, and associated young stocks, 1,400 acres, roughly speaking, in cropping at this point in time. I mentioned Nelson Dairy Consultants. They have used this firm very successfully for 35 years. This young man, Jeremiah, I want to talk about him a little bit because he's quite a story, and he tells you more about what the Lyon family is about. They have had various interns. They have provided summer jobs for Iowa State students. They have provided other employees for the two-year students at two-year colleges in the general area. Well, Jeremiah happened to be one of those young people. He actually worked for them when he was at a two-year college, went off to Iowa State. As Eric says, he thought he was going to go home and milk cows, and today he's a very, very successful nutritionist. So this is the kind of opportunities that also come out on the human resource side from this operation. Make special mention of two other individuals who work with the herd on a continuing basis, the vet, Dr. Rick Cooper, and Dr. Don Forthman, who does the ultrasound and the other repro work on that regard. So let's take a quick walk through the young stock facilities. Again, it's not anything that's particularly unique, except for it works for them, okay? Approximately 110 stalls in these two long barns that, as you can see at the end of August, have got the sides up, the curtains are up on the south side, and it's very comfortable for these calves in there. But when Iowa winters set in, then the sides can come down, the curtains can go up and down as they need to. And it's also very good for people working with these calves. They're feeding whole milk for 60 days. No, it is not pasteurized at this point. They take a lot of care to do the basic sanitation at this level rather than look at pasteurization at this point. And paying particular attention to low bacteria counts in the colostrum that they feed also. So you saw there a transition barn, the calves weaned, come into that barn, then they end up being grouped, and then ultimately they're going to end up at this facility up here. The day I arrived, it had rained 2 inches overnight. We apologize for the mud. We know you understand. The barns are all bedded pack. Okay, so they're coming out of these bedded pack barns onto these lots that a little wet that day. But what you also saw there at the end, and I'm not going to go back to it, is a group of the bulls. So if you look here and we go back down through this, you're going to see that there are calves that have blue tags, and there are calves that have pink tags. Would you like to take a guess as to what that means? In point of fact, yeah, there's a whole bunch of little bulls right there. If a calf's born at Lyon jerseys, it's basically raised because they have developed a market for their young bulls. In the past 10 years, they have sold 960 bulls for breeding purposes in one at a time, sometimes truckloads at a time, to commercial operations. And when they sell these bulls, they go with all of the proper health tests. They're reasonably priced. But the other thing, they go with their registration certificate. So the pedigree, the animal ID information is there. If the new owner wants to use it, they've got it. If they don't, they don't have to. But they've got it. The demand from commercial herds has not been slowing down. And it's very, very rare, Eric tells me, that they'll end up with an old bull that needs to go to the stockyards before he's got a new home with a bunch of black and white heifers, usually, because the calving ease is a huge issue in developing their bull market. So let me take a quick breath here, and we'll take a look at the cows. I think I said earlier that feeding a TMR one time a day. It's pushed up several times throughout the day. And this is the newest barn. As you can see, incredibly comfortable on what was a 90 degree day and high humidity when I was there. Sand bedded, clean. You see how it's all scraped down. And the cows are also very comfortable and clean. What are they feeding at this point in time? Well, this is based upon the BMR variety of corn that is grown for silage at the operation, on the dairy or on the farm. And they are now feeding 84, yeah, she's a lot of fun, isn't she? Don't ever try to take video of jerseys, they'll be in your face before you know it. they're feeding right now 84 pounds per cow on an as-fed basis, that's 46 pounds on dry matter basis. That includes about 28 pounds of corn silage, 50% of which is that high digestibility variety that they grow. Haylage at 15 pounds, wet gluten at 15 pounds, cottonseed at 5. A few other things that I'll go past here. Long hay goats in at about a pound and a half, and straw in at a half a pound, plus a base mineral mix that they put in here that they're doing some things. Jeremiah is doing some things to try to prevent problems from overeating and also delayed corn digestion with the various additives that he's putting in there. Cows are warmed up for about 2 weeks, and it's an important thing to also note about Lyon jerseys. Back in the day when everybody said, jerseys, milk fever, you know, don't want to mess with them, Lyon jerseys was a research site for the development of the DCAD and milk fever prevention diets that were done at the National Animal Disease Laboratory by Dr. Jesse Goff and Dr. Ronald Horst. Again, one of those things that they are in this to develop and contribute to the overall benefit of the dairy industry. I'm going to stop on her right now, and I don't think I can. That is an excellent 92-point Ayatollah. She finished last year with 26,000 pounds of milk at 5.3%, almost 1,400 pounds of fat actual. So what you've got here, and you've been seeing these pictures as I've been kind of talking over it, right? They weren't selected. And you're going to see this cow group of cows come through here. We didn't select them as they walked into that parlor. This is what you get when you visit this operation. You're going to see lots and lots of really fine cows, very functional cows that have good udders. And every once in a while, there's going to be a couple of there, like that Ayatollah. They're just going to knock your socks off. They're just tremendous, tremendous cows. I want to say one thing while I'm still on this. Both Joe and Eric have been judges at the national and international level. And I think that eye and their appreciation of what good cows are, what good udders are, what quality means, but also with a cow that has to milk to pay the bills is what you see reflected in this operation. And again, a nice picture of them leaving the parlor, how clean it is and so forth. And I'm sorry, I just had to put this in because that's just a beautiful view of those cows in that set of stalls, okay? If you follow Lyon Jersey's ads in Jersey Journal, there's a headline that's going to be in about every other ad, if not every one, depending on Eric's mood. And it's this one, butter equals gold. And so he wanted to put this in here and share with you what they're getting the pay price is right now, why it matters to them to increase the amount of butter fat and the amount of protein coming out of these cows. So for 2014 to date, the average pay price has been about $29 a hundredweight. They are shipping to Swiss Valley, as you saw on the original sign. For the month of August, they're paid $2.84 a pound for butterfat, $3.15 a pound for protein. There's the pounds that were shipped. And there's your monthly gross revenue. So almost $78,000 just from butterfat sales and just a smidgen under $60,000 for protein. For the year to date, there's where it's at. So about $535,000 from butterfat, almost, $670,000 from protein. And the thing of it is that he's convinced that butterfat has caught up on the price and it's going to take the lead going forward. And that's why they pay attention to increasing the butterfat in the way that they do. All right, there's a few of the records. That's 1,000 pounds fat or more in 2013. I would just, again, that Ayatollah cow that I pointed out to you, there's her record right there. And you get the sense, look at the final score on these cows. So many high, very goods and excellence in the herd. Let's talk a little bit about the cattle sales. You walk into the barn, and they're in the parlor, and you come past this set of pictures that are just stapled to the wall. And it's kind of interesting because what you get a sense of is what they put their value on, okay? The kinds of cows that they're looking at breeding, the kind of cows who have come to the forefront and who represent the operation year after year and evolve into it. And that's pretty much been the story, you know? Their advertising in Jersey Journal is not jam-packed full of a bunch of pictures and hasn't been for many years. What they've done is told a story. They've had a cow or two that they've pictured, and she's carried the story. In other words, you come to Lyon jerseys, and there are more where this cow came from. So what this group here is, I'll talk a little bit more, but Eric wanted to share again this philosophy. That, you know, population genetics is a way of life, but he wants to focus on well-proven bulls and young sires that fit their specific goals, and the ultimate judge, as far as they're concerned, the benchmark of their success is whether or not the commercial dairyman is going to come to them and ask them to buy another truckload out of there to build their own herd. And that's probably where it all started. There was a bull that they bought out of Michigan for $500 by the name of Jester B. Noble Aim. And by the time he came to 1958 at the first All-American, there's the story, the question, what's a Jersey daddy worth? Well, at that point in time, okay, remember, this is 1958, that Jersey bull had made them $49,000. And this sign over here is really quite fascinating because what it does is it breaks it down in terms of milk sales, what they'd been able to sell as excess breeding stock, both at public auction, private treaty, the inventory value of the cows by this bull in the herd, and then the fact that they had just sold the bull for $6,000 to COBA, which is now within the Select Sires Federation. That's a lot of money in 1958, okay? And then the real piece de resistance of this whole thing is this cow here on the end, because basically she was a feature of the All-American sale that year, in the revival, and she had just been named Grand Champion at the National Dairy Cattle Congress. She ended up selling for $6,000, went to Colorado, and established a long-term relationship between the Lyon family and the Johnson family. And so it was all very successful and wonderful relationship develop over that time. One of the things that I remember as a kid growing up in Kansas was is Lyon jerseys was always at the shows. And this was a major form of promotion, okay? And they'd always take and put up a nice display, and you'd get to see these cows in groups, and you'd get a sense not of individuals, but the whole breeding program, okay? Same thing, they spent a lot of effort to make these group pictures along the way. So let's talk about some of the basic individuals or the prominent individuals, and here's where we're going to start with Lyon Sooner Kane. She was the Iowa cow of the decade in the for the 90s. She was, when they had a Hordes Dairyman judging class in 1997, she was in that class. She was the winner of it. And that cow finished with 20,000 and 980, almost 1,000 fat. On her third record, okay? And she carried the banner for a long time. Then probably the most famous cow, particularly for those of you who watch the shows here at World Dairy Expo, is this cow. This is Lyon Duke Duchy. And again, one of those interesting stories because she actually was sold as a winter yearling in the Legends of the Fall sale in about 2003. So she sold. She went to a partnership that she won the Wisconsin Spring Spectacular. This is her picture there. Went excellent as a two-year-old, when you could go excellent as a two-year-old. Sold in 2005 in the Field of Dreams sale. Then had a very good campaigning with the Elliott and Budgeon herds. And then ended up selling at Private Treaty, if I remember right, Kim. She went through the Budgeon sale. Okay, thank you. And went to River Valley Dairy in Illinois. At this point, this cow has developed into this tremendous individual that at calving at 11 years of age, finished with 19,000 pounds of milk and 8.92 of fat. She is excellent 95, having been scored that on two different occasions. She was the grand champion of the All-American Junior Show in 2009. And frankly, the list of this cow's winnings goes on and on. But there she is in her glory. And you could see where she was before when she started and left Lyon jerseys. That established some relationships that resulted in some other purchases between River Valley and from the Lyon herd, one of the cows being this Best Begonia. She's excellent 92. She was at that point the intermediate champion at the Iowa State Fair in 2009. Her best record, almost 20,000 at 5.5%. There's an interesting story behind this young heifer, because I don't think there's a heifer picture anywhere in the Lyon folder at the Jersey Journal archives except for her. In 2010, that's when genotyping was getting its foothold. And the Pot of Gold sale was the first one of all breeds to test every heifer and sell them all genotyped. This heifer was supposed to have been a bull. And you'll see why when I talk about her pedigree in a second. She was genotyped and sold and topped and set a new record for the Pot of Gold sale at $10,750 going to Sidney Alvala in Texas. Okay, her dam was an excellent 92-point Jace with 11.28 of fat. And the next dam was a 90-point Paramount with 11.11 of fat. And her last record was started at 10 years and 2 months of age. This heifer then calved out. She's now very good 86. She was fourth in the Pot of Gold contest. And her most recent record, second lactation of 20,000 pounds of milk at 5.5, at 5.5%, 1,100 pounds of fat, and 3.9 of protein. So there's one of another one of the great success stories. The Lyons have always been huge supporters of the youth programs and of the Pot of Gold sale. 50th anniversary of the Kentucky National sale. They had this young cow. She just calved. They put her in, projected to 20,000 pounds of milk, again at 5%. She ended up being purchased by Waverly Farm. She has gone excellent 91. She was the reserve intermediate champion at the Harrisburg show. And her dam is an excellent 92 rocket, again, with 1131 of fat. Here's a more interesting little heifer, because this is actually a tequila daughter that just is a junior two-year-old, milking about to high 50s right now. She was third at the Iowa State Fair in August. Her dam is a 91-point Ayatollah with 1182 of fat, and the next dam is also excellent. And it's just one of those things of, you know, breeding some things that are different to draw in some other customers to the operation. Another interesting little project has been this cow, Bachelor's Sambo Emmy 661. She is a cow that Eric has loved ever since he first saw her as a two-year-old at the All-American. She was the winner of the 2002 National Jersey Jug Futurity. She is one of only two cows to have been premier performance winner at the All-American Jersey Show in Louisville. She was brought out there to do an IVF project. They've got 10 heifers that are still waiting to calf her, on her, but five of them have also been sold out to pay for the IVF, and now it'll be interesting to see what these 10 heifers that they've got develop into. But a tremendous daughter of the Lester Sambo bull. The star, as far as I'm concerned today, this is me, is this cow, Lyon Character. She is excellent 94. She was a top 200 JPI cow, Jersey Performance Index cow. She won her class at the Iowa State Fair. She has a Jersey Udder Index of 4.39. She finished a record of 1,322 pounds of fat and 854 of protein. She's a double-bred great-granddaughter of Duncan Bell because she has Paramount on the top side and Perimeter on the bottom. And she happens to be the dam of a bull that's getting worldwide marketing by the name of Lyon Impulse Louis Chart, which is one of his daughters here. He's being marketed in the UK, Italy. He's quite successful for ABS at this point. And you see the profile on this bull, right? You're looking at the udder composite is way over here. And again, he's reflecting the breeding philosophy as it has played out to this point in the game. That happens to be a sister to the Chart bull. She is at River Valley Dairy. She has just produced a son that has released a son by Critic P. She's, let me see if I can find my notes here. She's very good at 88 points and has finished a two-year-old record at 18,000 at 865 of fat. So I think the point here is to give you some sense of just the overall breeding program, the philosophy as it's played out in pictures. These five cows here were just taken in about the last 6 weeks, and I'll go through them briefly. The cow in the middle is a sister to the one we just showed you. She is 87 points, has a Jersey Udder Index of 5.85, almost 6. So very extreme in that regard. She's going to make about 1,000 pounds this year of fat. The cow here is a polled daughter of Eclipse that's 84, a two-year-old that's projected to 1,300 of fat. The next cow, a Blair daughter, that's actually 92 points. She was the first five-year-old at the Iowa State Fair this year. The Elvia cow is by a homebred bull. She is 87 and is going to make 1,000. And then the cow on the end is by the Louis bull. She is excellent, and she's going to also make 1,000 pounds of fat this year. That's the herd. Let's talk the people. Joe Lyon, in his various roles with milk marketing cooperatives, with the American Jersey Cattle Association, with the National Dairy Promotion Board, has been one of the best friends and greatest supporter of the dairy industry that I know. I started as a graduate of Kansas State University when he was president of National All Jersey, and we were just getting the equity program off the ground. And over the years, he has been an untiring supporter of multiple component pricing, of better breeding programs. He has been a true leader for us. And just wanted to include this picture here because I see Carl Zerberg's sitting right back here. And that was a great occasion. World Dairy Expo, wasn't it? Dairy Man of the Year is when he got that. And that's a picture of Carl and his wife and Joe and his wife, Duffy. So, let's talk about Duffy for a little bit because you just basically can't do it. In some circles, Duffy was far more famous than Joe. I mean, this is a woman who went on the David Letterman show and stood up very well against David Letterman. She's known as the Butter Cow Lady. She had developed quite a career as an artist and a sculptor over the years. And we'd like to share with you this little clip that was done in 1974 by Iowa Public TV.
Oh. Rockers at the Iowa State Fair with Mrs. Norma Lyon and the cow.
Yes, all 350 pounds of her.
And you are from where, Mrs. Lyon?
Toledo, Iowa.
Toledo, Iowa. You, I understand, make this buttered cow every year for the fair?
Yes, this is the 15th one I've made for Des Moines.
In other words, that's 15 years?
That's right.
Why?
Oh, I like to do it. It's a good out for me, and I bring the children, they get a little vacation out of it, and it pays well.
Where do you get all the butter?
This came from Fern, Iowa. It was churned a special batch with no salt in it.
Oh, normal butter has salt?
Yes.
I didn't know that. Well, how long does it take you to...
It took a day and a half.
A day and a half?
Yes.
To complete?
Yes, to finish her.
Do you have to be pretty good at sculpting to do this?
Well, you've got to know where all the muscles and bones are in the cow and the thing, whatever you're working on, and muscles, and so you have to know something about it.
Now, I understand that you don't make the same type of cow every year.
I make a different breed every year. There's six major breeds of the dairy cattle, and this is the third year in my third series.
And this type of breed would be what?
Brown Swiss.
A who?
A Brown Swiss.
Brown Swiss.
Mm-hmm.
Originally from Switzerland?
They're bred in Switzerland, and you'll find them all in Germany and Italy and France.
I don't imagine one cow is more difficult to sculpture than the other, is it?
Oh, yes. This particular one is one of the most difficult.
Why?
Oh, I have... the heads are the hardest for me to do. And to get that eye just right is real painstaking. And I have to go outside and see what it looks like. Because when you're in here and right on top of her, you can't tell exactly how she looks until you go outside and get away from her at a distance.
What happens to the butter after you're finished?
It goes to
byproducts. After the display is finished?
It goes to byproducts, national byproducts, and it goes into dog food and chicken feed.
Oh.
It isn't used by... Actually, the butter on this particular cow mm-hmm. is going to be made into another cow.
When?
At National Dairy Cattle Congress late in September.
Mrs. Lyon, I think you have a butter hobby than most of us.
Thank you.
Wanted to share that, and also want you to know that if you want to share it with family and friends, it's on YouTube. It's still out there, and it's just delightful. Before I go on here and call on Kurt to identify folks here in the family, something that's also been interesting about the Lyon herd is that because of good friends and some family over the years, there's been more than jerseys in that barn. You know, Duffy was a good, had good eye for cows, all right, as the rest of them do. The national grand champion, Brown Swiss cow, Schulte's Sunwise Pat, actually walked into those barns. A milking shorthorn by the name of Clayside Cindy, also a grand champion, was there. And because of some friends who have Ayrshires, they've had multiple state fair winner from the Ayrshire breed living at Lyon jerseys, so... All right, let me call on Kurt to walk up here and identify this very large family for you, if you would, please.
Thank you. Yeah, go a little higher. Yeah, it's going to come. Thank you, Sherrod. I kind of had to look twice and figure out who they all were, too. But the easiest thing, I guess, is oldest to youngest. Of course, mom and dad in the middle. That's our oldest sister, Emily, who is in River Falls, retired high school English teacher. And she now, her retirement hobby is with her daughter, Abby. They have a restaurant just, I think, the north end of Main Street near the campus. And they're running a little restaurant cafe type deal, Dish and the Spoon. So that even kind of has a nursery rhyme cow theme to it, too. I'm looking for her son, and I don't see Jeff. Oh, right above him, her older one. And Jeff is in North Carolina, and Abby's there in River Falls. They each have two kids. Then the next one would be Brother Mark. He's down in South Carolina. He worked for Charlie McGinnis for quite a few years and then had his own herd for a while, which he recently dispersed. He had some health trouble and is getting along pretty well, but mostly at home yet. And so that his wife, Bonnie, was a high school sweetheart, and they married, and she followed him down to South Carolina and following his dream of milking Jersey cows, which he has. Their older boy, Josh, former Marine and working in, I think, nuclear refueling type stuff. Their daughter, Samantha, school teacher in South Carolina, and their other daughter, Rachel, who married an Army enlistee in that there, I think in El Paso or something like that. So that's Mark's crew there. And just kind of an aside, our claim to fame is we have the only redheaded kids in the family. Mark's got two daughters and then mine here. So the Bohemian just don't see a lot of redhead in Bohemian, so we kind of had to get the outcrosses for that. Brother Eric is here. And then his wife Terry, a Southern Iowa Irish. And get through their crew here. Tom is the oldest. He went through Air Force Academy as an engineer at a pharmaceutical plant in Utah. Their next boy, Ty, is also a Air Force Academy graduate, and he is flying heavies, yet still cargo planes, and he's in Texas right now, I think. Their next boy, Ted, is a landscape architect in Ames, Iowa. He married a dairy princess from Decorah, Iowa, Kayla Hotfoot, and her dad milks 600-700, I think. Larry, is that right up in that area? So they're both in Ames. She works for, I think, Iowa Federation of Cooperatives. Their daughter, Erin, just recently married Memorial Day, found a good German stock from Western Iowa, Carroll County, and I think they're going to be moving from Ames back to that area, Western Iowa. And there should be one more. Ted is, that's one. Geez, old Pete, he's got to be there somewhere. I think. Well, yeah, we'll come across him sooner or later. Lions are like bad pennies. We just keep coming back, I guess. That's Michelle, her husband, Tim. There's Michelle. Next daughter, elementary school teacher in Greene, Iowa, about an hour and a half northwest of home. Her husband, Tim, was a music instructor, recently retired, also in Greene. And two children, daughter Allison, married to a guy in a residency program, I think at Case Western Medical in Cleveland. And then Jake, their boy, is in London now, finished a postdoc, offered a job at a university there, I think in psychology. So we generally marry pretty well and do that. So. Brother Greg and his wife Kathy milked, I think, up to 300-400 jerseys in Adelissa, just a little east of Iowa City. Greg's had a little health trouble, and they're out of cows right now, but they've got also five kids, and I'll start looking for tall ones now is where we're going. Lindsay's the second oldest, but a daughter. She was a volleyball player and coach at a community college in Ottumwa, southern Iowa. Just married over the 4th of July. I think there's the oldest, Luke, in the home area, driving trucks and doing other jobs, a bunch of stuff. Oh, Luke and Oakley. I'll have to kind of fake it here. There is G. Oakley and Logan. And that's got to be one. I don't know, that's Australian. Nope, they're all in the front. So that's going to be... I think Logan, and then the baby, Michaela, Lakea, she's still in high school there. They just recently moved to Clarence, Iowa, about halfway between probably home and Clinton on the river, and so she's, I think, a junior there. So Gregson, and actually that's the top half of the family, and you can see after Greg graduated, that's kind of when we got into the bull business, because we didn't need to steer meat anymore. We could had bulls to raise and sell, and didn't have to worry about keeping the freezer stocked. So that was it. The next one, Valerie's sister. She is a like a cost accountant engineer in the oil business. She actually moved to Australia and had three boys there, David, Ashley, they call him Dak, and Gavin, I think, is the next one, and Hayden is the baby, and actually another doctor in the family there, I think. And then Lori is our only, well, you know, it's kind of a mixed blessing here. She is a University of Iowa graduate, so that kind of chopped things up a little bit for us. But doing pretty well. She's in Phoenix and in technology industries and that kind of stuff. Her husband, John, another local kid, I guess. Their daughter, another volleyball player. She is 6 foot something. Kyle Michelle, and their younger one, Sam. And I think he's a sophomore now at Arizona State. That left me, oops, look at that, took too long. I was up in the upper right corner. We've been lucky. We moved to Green Bay 25 years ago. Ellen was just about half a year old. Actually, Ellen was born in Columbus, Ohio, and I was a short stint learning a lot from Sherry and the crew at Dairy Cattle Association. Found out I wasn't so much a cow man as a milk guy, maybe kind of like, or dad was both, but went to work for a co-op there, first as a fieldman, and then now I'm a distributor for IBA, a dairy products company. And my wife, Jane, a Western Iowa product, we met at Iowa State. Again, our daughter, Ellen, who just moved to Denver and is in cardiac rehab exercise physiology, so she's, after you have the heart attack, she puts you to work and starts exercising you and gets you back into shape. And then youngest brother, Doug, right in there, he's in Minneapolis, so a partner there, and owns a UPS store. So that's most of the crew. So I'll just kind of take this opportunity to thank Sherry. Watching that public TV video versus the one that you shot, I guess video has come a long way. It's amazing to see the clarity and all that, but your work and the production of that kind of stuff, it's a deal. And just to see the room full, it's overwhelming to me how many friends that the family has collected over the years, and we thank you all for that. And stop in anytime. I'm in Green Bay, but I mean stop in Toledo. They'll be happy to.
Thank you, Kurt. Nine children, five sons, four daughters. The other families as part of this in Jerseys have all made it happen. So I want to go just another step further, you know, a little bit more of an homage to Duffy, because she passed away in late June of 2011. We miss her dearly, everybody does, and she was a tremendous person for promoting the dairy industry. And there's another example of it, the Jersey Jewels bronze sculpture that ended up at Iowa State University. So as Kurt said, and I know we want to join in on this, there's the contact information. We can give it to you at the Jersey booth also. Eric's son, Todd, is quite a photographer here. This is another one of Duffy's sculptures, which is there in Toledo, Iowa. You saw it on the first slide in the daylight in the spring. This is in the snow, and it's just truly a great way to know that you're in Jersey country when you're in Toledo, Iowa. So on behalf of the American Jersey Cattle Association, we want to say thank you so much for joining us today and hope you have a good afternoon.